not morning, it's 12:47. I'm on a windy road to the vet. So this morning, actually found my sunglasses. I don't typically talk with my glasses on. My glasses on. I do like them. Got good audio? Testing 1, 2, 3. So I can see myself in here. I was like, ah, I look terrible. Headed to take Giggles in for her radical mastectomy. Boy, that didn't look good, did it? I'm like, need to exercise my bat wings. I know, I hate that. I never thought I'd have bat wings. All right, you old ladies, go ahead, laugh with me. All right, you young ladies, work on your arms so you don't get 60 and have bat wings. I'm not 60 yet, but I'm close. Giggles is asleep behind me. And this is an elective surgery I'm having done on her to... I'll take a picture. I'll do a before and after picture. That would be a really good thing, and you'll see why I'm doing this. And her tissue just, everybody's different, you know, how they're made. And she just didn't have little perky tits. She had long, saggy ones. It was really hard for the puppies to latch on to. So her little girl is doing wonderful. This is the very interesting thing about those two puppies that were born, though. The little boy, I haven't named him. I think I'll name him Leroy. Leroy and Lynn. L-I-T-E-N, Litin, 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 I don't know how you say it. He's eating out of a bowl, really good, because he was 3 weeks old Saturday, and she's eating some dog food when I spoon feed her, and Callie's litter is beginning to erupt their front teeth. I can feel their teeth. They're finally pooping solid. Mustard across the room. Green mustard, yellow mustard, brown mustard. Was it gray poupon or just regular mustard? Stink. I don't know. White. They really kind of. They absolutely. Last week was hard week. Last week was a really hard week. I need to do a video, although I'd gross everybody out. Callie has a gaping hole in her, and I have started letting them nurse again, so I take a big towel and I hold it over that tit and the two holes, and when I've been doing water therapy on it, hunks of tissues come out of it, just make you vomit if you didn't have a strong stomach, which I do. So this was funny. As a kid, we would sit around the table and talk about butchering hogs or whatever. So I just grew up. I never had a weak stomach. And then when I worked in the turkey plant, you were cutting turkeys open or pulling their guts out or whatever you were doing. And then we had these aprons, they call. They're waterproof, so we didn't get our uniforms wet. And take all of that off. Quite a bit to take off, and we didn't take our boots off, but get all your gloves and everything off. Go to the break room. So by then, you only had about 7 or 8 minutes to get something to eat or drink or go to the bathroom. Then you had to put it all back on and get back on the line, because when that line started, you had to be there. So, and after 8 hours, you were hungry. If it was time to eat, you ate whatever. If you had chicken poop hanging, it didn't matter. You didn't have to eat, but this stuff didn't bother me. I just ate. So this was my childhood. We would butcher our own hogs. It's always November, really cold day. We always wanted it cold so there weren't flies. So it's usually below freezing when we would do this in the day. And it was a lot of work. There was another family that would come and also underneath that cast iron bathtub and get the water boiling. Well, after you killed your hog and you drained the blood out, we scalded him before we gutted him, pretty sure. I was pretty young. So you have him hooked up. I know this is awful. Bat wings. By his back legs, and you, with the winch, and you pushed him down into this boiling hot water, and then you had to winch him back up out of there. And he's hot. So you're not trying to cook him. You're not trying to cook his flesh. You're scalding him. And then you take a knife and you scrape all that hair off. Because, I mean, you know, they're like nasty. I don't remember if we washed them. Papa probably did. After they killed him and before they dipped him to get any yuck off of him. So then you're scraping all this hair off, right? Until all the skin is clean. And you just keep dipping him and putting them down in that scalding hot water and pulling them up, and everybody has got a long knife and we're all scraping on the hog. I know, you people have no idea where your food comes from. Then you gut the hog and clean out, it's clean. So if you've never butchered, it's really amazing to look inside an animal. It's amazing, and it's just, I don't know, I can't think of another word. I can't think of another good word besides amazing, because everything is just so perfect the way it fits together in there. And you have to be really, it's all clean. People are like, oh, that's gross, it's dirty. It's not. You have to be careful not to bust a gut, or, you know, you get into poop. But if it's all together, it's not dirty at all in there. It's beautiful and it's clean. Actually, it's almost sterile. Then we would take the hog. The hard part was scraping him. Then we would take him. It was so cold. He's getting cold, right? The meat's getting cold, and that's what we want it to do. We want the meat to get really cold. We had this old house. We would hang this hog in this old house. And we would do 2 to 4 a day because this meat would last us all year. Then we would begin to cut that meat up. So here was my point. So I was raised to have a strong stomach. All the scraps they would give us kids, and we had these big, they're antique stuff now, but they were lined in white, and they might have had a red rim or a blue rim. Anybody that's my age will remember these things. Kind of like, almost like a porcelain finish to a tin. To a piece of metal. It's kind of like a porcelain finish in there. And as kids, Papa had made up a grinder that was hooked up to an old ringer type washer. So the ringer type washer has a motor that's causing the ringers to go round and round. So it was causing this grinder to grind, right, to go round and round. And we just turned it off, turned it on. So that was our job as children. This is what we had to do. I mean, we were probably 6 or 7, and we were always washed up and clean, but we would take those scraps and we would feed them through the grinder and make sausage, and then we would put them in these big, clean, huge things, and we would sprinkle seasoning on it, and then we would do this, and then we would go in the house and fry us some fresh sausage, because we hadn't had any fresh sausage since the last November. And what? I mean, we would make enough to last almost a year, keep it in the freezer. We would cut up the entire hog. Probably, I think our hogs were around 300 to 400 pounds. That's 400 pound hog is a huge hog to put up. So that's what I'm saying. I don't have a weak stomach. I would help them butcher. Then we would make sausage, then we would run in there. And that's usually what we had for supper, was sausage and gravy and biscuits. Because our mama would always put a big pot of beans on too. Because we would just work. I mean, we would work. It's all we could work. And in growing up as children, we learned to work because no one sat around while parents would look at them and say, what did you produce today? Did you produce enough to eat? Did you produce enough to feed yourself today? And I'm not saying that at 7 years old, you should be producing enough to feed yourself, to sustain yourself. It is, but I'm saying this, the generation that is on the earth now certainly has an entitlement mentality that they're going to sit on their ass and expect someone else to feed them. And that's wrong. In 2 Thessalonians, Paul says, if you won't work, you shouldn't eat. Everybody can do something. And I just grew up as a child. We all, and we never thought of it as work. And I think this mentality of work as punishment or whatever is, that's not God and godly. God asked Adam to work. There's nothing wrong with work. Work is not a bad thing. Work is a good thing. So, anyway, you know me when I get to talking. I don't know what I was talking about. Killing hogs and making sausage. So I grew up butchering wheat. Tanya has butchered a lot this summer. We haven't butchered in months. Of course, we've been offered a couple of things, and Tim's passed on it. But I enjoy butchering. It doesn't bother me a bit. I don't really like gutting them. Because a cow, you know, you've got at least 100 pounds of guts. And the first 3 stomachs, the dogs will eat. And after that, the closer you get to the butthole, the less they like it. You have to be really hungry to eat that. Dogs hot spots, feeding horses, it's so hot. We used to be with a horse rescue and a horse equine vet. That's all he does is horses, and he hasn't called us in a long, long time to come pick something up. I don't know why, but although a horse will make a lot of meat, a horse will make way more meat than a cow. They're just made different, and it's sad. Sometimes I cry when I knew a horse, especially if I knew it was a well-loved horse. One time we did a white pony of these children, and he had cancer all over. And the children had ridden him and held on to his mane, and you could see where they would hold on to him. Anyway, I know, it was sad. It was very sad. And then we had someone else bring us their old horse, and they just didn't want to take care of it anymore. It was really sad. Anyway, it's sad. So we're headed to Green Forest to do Giggle's operation. I probably won't stay. Probably will go to the feed store. You know, I should have brought Legacy. I never thought about that, about going to the feed store. He hadn't been to town in 2 weeks, I know. Well, Wednesday. I should have brought him. I was just in such a hurry. My brother-in-law was there. He hurt himself Friday. He can barely walk. He can barely move. He has to move his left leg with his hand almost to get his leg to move. So I took him by my neuropath. She's amazing. I expect her to fix him right up. Because it's Mow Monday and nothing's getting mowed. Working with my other helper, and I really, really like her. I mean, she's just respectful, and just trying to get her to, seems like in her mind, she doesn't think clearly. She'd been in Illinois working, and I called her, and Yeah. It's like, thank you. Anyway, you know, people are just precious. It just really touches my heart. People are precious. And I mean, it would have been okay for her to say no if she had another patient coming in. I understand that. But because she didn't, she was willing to go out of her way and drive, I don't know, 2 miles and take him back into town. So, at our town, we don't have traffic. We just got a stoplight a couple of years ago. So we were the only county in Arkansas that did not have a stoplight because we didn't need one. Seriously. Lost 50. from Jackson, Mississippi. He said he's going to do Biloxi and Mobile. I was like, I don't want to hear about the shows you're doing, okay? Just stop it, because I want to go, and I can't go, so just go away. Because I've got Steffi, and I've got, after that, a little bit after that, I've got Cinnamon and Serenity, so they're probably 3 weeks, so 5 weeks, Cinnamon and Serenity. $2,000 on the sperm. And then it was almost $700 to ship it in and $500 to do the surgical AI. But praise God, I'm praying that her uterus was not scarred. So here's the problem: if they get a uterine infection, that pus scars their uterus. So that's why I should have just got down on the floor and had a hissy fit and said, you'll give me Baytril or I'll go somewhere else Wednesday, because you don't want infection in that uterus. And I'm not saying the infection was in the uterus, but she was running 103 something and she felt terrible, so it really made me feel like she did have an infection Wednesday after her surgical AI on Saturday. So here's another weird thing that happened. She was passing like clumps of tissue. It was really weird. Anyway, I'm going to stop here and get me an ice cream. And I have 20 minutes to get to Dr. Ron's. Yay me. You know, should just go down to Sonic and get me a burger. I can't believe I didn't bring Legacy. I'm going to sign off because I'm going to get an ice cream. I can't give her anything because she's fixing to have a incubated a tube down her throat. Oh my gosh, I have ran off and forgot my purse. Oh Lord, well I'm glad I don't need gas. Lucky me. I cannot believe I did that. I was in such a hurry to get out of there. Oh, I got a few dollars here. I know my credit card number. Actually, I could go by Arvis Bank and get what I wanted. Well, I don't know without my driver's license. They don't know me over here. That's not like me to run off without my purse. I didn't think about it till now. Oh well. Shopping trip I wanted without my purse. If I asked my vet to front me $100, he would. He's so wonderful. Okay, I'm signing off for an ice cream. Bye.